Everybody, welcome to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Joined today by my buddy Will Hahn, who's your former everything, but currently your trainer for Justin Barsha, Pierce Brown, Josh Ferries, and Michael Mosman.
Yep.
Right?
Correct.
Same role you had the last time you were on the show, but I invited you on the show this time because you did something pretty gnarly on a personal level recently.
Yep.
And I'm so impressed by it. I wanted to hear about it and talk about it. So the Leadville 100 is a brutal cross-country mountain bike race that covers 100 miles. And I mean, some ungodly amount of elevation, right?
Yeah. Well, and it's funny too. Like, you go in there thinking it's 100. Well, it's ended up being like 105.1, which I know doesn't sound
5.1
like,
is.
Yeah, like, oh, 5 miles isn't that big of a deal. Well, it is. It is, especially at their, you know, 8 hour mark.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was gnarly. It starts at, you know, 10,000 feet of elevation already. So you're already up high, battling those effects. And then,
so wait, 10,000 feet, that's already higher than Mammoth, isn't it?
Yeah. I think if I remember right, and I could be off on this, but I remember the top of the hill, I think after the start, I think that was 10K or damn close. So like, yeah. So you got to think like that is where we started at the very top of the hill after the start. So. Uh-huh.
So did you go ahead of time to acclimate?
No, because going off of what I knew from racing and racing at elevation and then like kind of just talking to some people and getting the feelers out, without going there like a month prior, I just didn't see the benefit. And obviously, I don't have the luxury of being able to do that anyway.
Yeah.
So no, I stayed here. I flew in Friday. I flew in Friday and raced Saturday.
Wow. Did you borrow Chad's elevation tent to sleep in at night?
No, and I probably should have done some more CVAC, and I could have done some more on my end, but I, like anything, just priorities came
just
first. And
my, okay, so my stuff I didn't last. Know you were training for it, right? Like, I saw you riding a bunch on your Instagram, but then all of a sudden you're at Leadville. I was like, holy shit, Will's doing this because you skipped Unadilla?
Yep, correct.
Yeah, to do that.
Which was weird, too, because we've never really had 2 weeks off. I don't remember outdoors. Mm-hmm. So then from Washougal to this weekend, it felt like I wasn't at a race for a really long time. And since I've been done racing, I haven't missed a race. So mm-hmm. It was, you know, well, I guess maybe one or two, depending on injuries on the team or stuff like that. But for the most part, haven't really missed too many. So it was honestly kind of weird for me as well on that break.
Mm-hmm. All right. So how many feet of climbing was it over 100 miles?
Ended up being 11,900.
Wow.
So 11,900 feet, which... Man, it was weird because I think the first half of the race actually I feel like went by pretty quickly, and that was by the time that was said and done, you're probably at 65 or 7,000 feet. But then thinking that you still had at least 5,000 more to go was pretty tough. And even though it's an out and back course, it doesn't feel like normally if you go out and back here or a normal day to day, you know where you're at, and there it was like it was a totally different course.
Yeah. So. Okay, I've done 100 miles on a mountain bike 3 times in my life, but it's not a race pace, right? So thinking about what you did racing is just mind-boggling, because I think I took 12 hours once and 11, and the fastest I ever did it was 10 hours, 40 minutes or something, right? And that was even cheating. I was on a cyclocross bike or a gravel bike.
Still got to climb, yeah.
But I can't imagine doing it with the adrenaline of it being a race.
Well, it was tough, right? Because everything you read going in, and like I was kind of putting feelers out to certain guys or people that have done it, and again, like I'm very, very lucky that I was with a group of people that have experienced it before that were helping me share their knowledge of just previously doing it, because the hardest part was just not knowing the course. Mm-hmm. Like I pre-rode maybe a half mile of it the day before, so like, you know, all this is blind and new to me, so but the more I read about it was that everyone's advice was just ride it like you're riding. Don't race.
Uh-huh.
And the group I was with that we started off, it was pretty casual. And I really held myself back for probably 3 hours because like any ego, when someone passes you, you want to go, right? Or like,
yeah.
And you know, the slower you go, the longer you're going to be out here. So you mm-hmm. do want it to go by quicker, but then I've never raced at that altitude and I've never trained at that altitude. So I was like, well, I didn't want to find out. I just knew if I went red that you weren't going to recover, or if you started cramping, you weren't going to recover and it might be over. And I just didn't mm-hmm. want to put it all down the drain because I wasn't diligent enough to hold myself accountable. Mm-hmm.
So what was the course like? Was it all fire roads or was it single?
For the most part, like, I mean, for the average person listening to know, like, I didn't run a dropper post. So nothing, nothing gnarly, I would say. Do I wish I would now, did I need a dropper? Yes, but not for what you think. Just the downhills to be able to suck myself down and like get more aero. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I didn't lose a significant amount of time doing that. Like people would just blow by me going down the downhills and I'm not a guy, I can't sit on the top tube.
Yeah.
Like I'm not going to get head shake and crash at 30 because I'm sitting on a tube trying to gain a couple seconds. So, but no, I mean, some of the downhills were tricky, I'd say. I think it's called Powerline. That one down was pretty rain ready and like somewhat tricky. But for us, like, and I take it for granted riding my whole life, like the dirt bike side of it took over and, it's really easy for me to pick lines through that stuff. Mm-hmm. Where you can see pretty visually, like it was hard for a lot of guys to pick lines or not be on the brakes super hard. And you'd smell brakes and stuff like that. But no, I mean, not really. No, it wasn't super technical. Mostly fire roads. There was some single track. But the other thing of that too, like there's a couple points to the ride where you're like literally when someone says God's country, like it was.
Yeah.
It was like there's a lake over here and then it's just so green. There's pine trees everywhere. And like where you're riding, you feel like you shouldn't be on a mountain bike. It feels like you're in a movie set of like something, the most beautiful thing you've ever seen, honestly.
Yeah. What was it like... physically, like, were you pain cave the whole time, or like, did you get to a point where you're like, I'm not gonna make it, or were you pretty solid the whole time?
I hit about every emotion, I feel like. and it was hard, dude, because like the first 3 hours felt very casual, very comfortable, and I felt very fit. And I think because I went in so late, I didn't feel the elevation. Like even at my low points on the ride, I don't really think it was elevation. Mm-hmm. So I'm pretty lucky there that I didn't, I mean, I've never had a problem with altitude sickness, but so mm-hmm. I'm lucky about that. But no, I think it was, I pulled too long on the back part from like mile, I would say probably like 65 to 70. So when you go out and you do a pretty substantial climb, like I'd say the most famous climb on the course, which is called Columbine. Mm-hmm. Then you come back down that and you have one last, another a planned stop where like my wife was and where some of our crew was. And you would come through there and then regroup, refill your bottles, do all that, get going again. And then from there to probably our next checkpoint, it was, you're pretty out on the own. It's a pretty bad headwind and you don't really want to be solo. And for a while I was, so mm-hmm. I had to like either wait or push forward. So I kind of checked up and then got with some guys. And then actually one of the guys I was staying with, the house we shared together, found him somehow randomly. And then we were all pulling together. Well, next thing I know, I just kind of popped. And mm-hmm. I knew that I couldn't keep that effort going. So I checked up and I seen Matt Smith was at one of the stops, one of the backhouse guys and races out here all the time, is very fit. And he said, hey, are you okay? And I'm like, no, I need a Coke or something, dude. Like, so he gave mm-hmm. me a Coke. And that actually, honestly, probably saved me. Mm-hmm. But then I was riding from there, which is probably like 5 more miles to see my wife. And that would be the last stop till the end. And that would be like mile 80. And so I get to her, and I'm kind of off just in general. Like, I looked down, and I honestly did want to quit. Because I knew right after her, there was another climb that was the hardest one at like, for like probably a mile or two, it averages over 20%. Mm-hmm. So it's nasty at mile 80 to hit something 20%. Like that.
20%.
I mean, I pushed most of it, to be honest with you. Yeah. I got off and there's too many people and it's rocky. But I had a moment where I just started crying. Like I started thinking about Fed and then him not being there. But then I'm also emotional where I wanted to quit and I could hear him like telling me basically to stop being
a pussy.
You know, pussy. And, yeah. And you've never quit anything. Why would you quit now? So I could like hear him like, yeah. In a way saying that, and I'm like, well, he's right. And then like, how could I face the guys when I get home? Like, yeah, sorry, I made it to 85, but I quit. And like, how does that look on me? You know, so I was like, no, you got to pull it together here no matter what. And honestly, I snuck in my AirPods, and I think had I not done that, to be able to just listen to some music, just to kind of get my brain back to not so negative, I guess. Yeah. I think that really helped me. But then I also ran into, so once I got to the top of this climb to a point, which it doesn't stop after that, right? You get to the top and you think it's over and it's still, like you can see guys way off in the distance, like tiny helmets still climbing. And mm-hmm. you're like, it looks like you're 2 days away from them. Mm-hmm. And you're like, fuck. Greg, one of the guys again that we were staying with, we came in or I saw him ahead of me. So I got up to him. And he was kind of bonking too. So luckily we had each other to kind of like talk to. He had ridden it before. So it was like, it was kind of nice for us to be together and kind of keep each other out of that, like, just battling demons, basically, right?
Yeah. Okay, so you cross the finish line. Is it just fall on the ground, exhausted?
No, I mean, I did kind of want to, but I think it was like you get another shot of adrenaline. Like when I finally finished and knew, for one, my goal was, it was a high-end goal, but my goal was 8.5, and it ended up being like 840 or 845, which to me, that was successful enough to call
fast.
It. Yeah, so I was like, I did it. And then it also, regardless of even my time, the fact that I still finished after what I've been battling, you know, 2 hours before that, where I was like, did want to quit, straight up wanted to quit, that I was really proud too. And then us kind of finishing together, not really knowing each other, like that's a kind of a bond that's kind of, it's different, right? Where you're like so deep in this pain that helping yourself get to that finish line. And yeah, I don't know, I crossed, saw my wife, saw the buddies that were there, and it was like, it was just a good feeling, honestly. Mm-hmm.
What did you do afterwards? I mean, you didn't cramp the whole time?
No, I got really lucky. I never cramped.
Okay, so you know that the cramps are coming in the middle of the night, right?
So well, I thought so, but it was more like stomach, like from just all processed, like, I mean, you're relying on heavy on gels and sugary processed stuff that's gonna get you through the day, because you, I mean, as bad as you want a steak or something, like it's just not an option. So
yeah.
Mostly afterwards, like in bed, like I actually felt really bad for Taylor because it was just the gas that I've never even experienced, like even at this level of like, we do that stuff normally daily or weekly races, right? Because that's the same stuff you're eating between motos and throughout the day to fuel you on a dirt bike. But yeah, it was rough.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I'm kind of disappointed you didn't bring that belt buckle, but you can send me a picture
now,
of it.
Now I feel like
we're going to put the picture of the belt buckle in here. That's the finishing thing. But that's probably like when you do a motocross Grand Prix, you get those cheesy little finisher pins, right?
Yeah.
Leadville, to get a Leadville belt buckle is a huge accomplishment.
No, and it was huge. And like this whole thing kind of stemmed from too, like just to be transparent with it, was like years ago, Fed and I had talked about doing it together. Like, hey, when you're done racing, we're going to do something like that. Because it was like, I remember, man, it was a long time ago, but I remember being there like, hey, let's do a marathon together. And he's like, I don't really like running. And he always hated running. And he's like, I mean, I'll run 5 miles, but 26 is not really for me. Well, eventually I checked that off, right, on my own, and then did it with some buddies, and then this and that. And I was like kind of searching for that next thing. And then we'd always talked about this event, like, we're going to do that together one day when you're done racing. And you know, we will for sure. But you know how that, in translation, all that stuff gets lost, and you grow up and your lives go like this. And then next thing you know, you haven't done it yet. And then losing him this year, it was like, I kind of needed to hold myself accountable.
That's awesome.
Which I got to give a big shout out to the guys at Leadville too. Like, I kind of told them my story, and they were kind enough to somewhat make some things happen to help me get in the event, because I wasn't able to get into all the qualifiers. So just knowing the past and everything like that, and like I said, they were really accommodating to that and knowing the story. And then honestly, I don't know if I'd have finished without like having him kind of like in the back of my head.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, we're going to take a quick break, hear from our sponsors, back for more.
I'm Aaron Fletcher.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
Josh Mode.
I'm Cameron McAdoo.
I'm Justin Brayton.
Hey, I'm Alvin Muskin.
I'm Malcolm Stewart.
I'm Jalen Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
Welcome back to the SML Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Again, here with Will Hahn. We heard about his adventures at Leadville. Like, I have one last question about Leadville. You said you snuck in your AirPods. So like, is it like no headphones allowed?
Well, I didn't know, because I feel like that's somewhat frowned upon, especially when you're like calling out holes or like any kind of race like that. I feel like you do need to be obviously paying attention.
Yeah, because like at over the hump, they're all, if I see you with headphones, black flag you, right?
Right. So it's normally very frowned upon, but I'm like, at some point of that ride, like, I feel like everyone kind of needs. Maybe they're out, or like, I mean, I didn't have, it's not like you have service, it's not like I could talk on the phone or anything like that. Anyway, I had no interest in doing that. I just wanted to have, I knew at some point that might be pretty feasible to like need just music, and it didn't even matter what it was.
Mm-hmm.
So
did you go for your usual Celine Dion?
No, it was more of like Reba McEntire. You know, I was trying to go back to country, my roots, obviously. Yeah. And then, Celine's more of like a dinner mood type for me.
Dinner mood?
Yeah.
Like Pound Town setting?
Mostly, yeah.
All right. So let's talk moto. What was it like? Like you had to tell the guys, hey, I'm going to miss Unadilla because I'm going to do this bicycle race. Was it like an easy pitch to the guys?
Yeah, because I feel like they respected the fact that I still have some goals to check off too. Mm-hmm. And obviously some of the guys that like knew about the event were like, understand the gnarliness of it and like I think the prestige of it. And then also just like, it's not easy to get in. It is expensive. It's a decent investment. Mm-hmm. You know, by the time you fly there, do all that. But I think that they all respected it in a big sense of like, not many people even do the event. So to do it and yeah, everyone was super lenient, including the team, like just in general, like TK and the guys as well, and including the riders, was they just supported it. Mm-hmm.
So that one day that you phoned me when it was like 104, and you, I think you got a flat, right? And I rescued you at the gas station.
Yeah, that was like,
was that training for this?
Yeah, totally. So Blake Ray and myself, we were like, I have this loop behind my house that's, it's 33 miles, it's 5,000 feet, it just sucks, right? And I'm like, we're gonna do it twice. So I wanted to do a couple rides of 10,000, or because I, again, thought the race was 10,000 feet, not 11.9, which again, another 2,000 feet of what you thought is a lot.
Yeah.
So I was like, well, I need to do that a couple times to get that feeling and to want to quit here before I get there. Mm-hmm. And then that day, yeah, we tried to fix it twice, ran out of tubes, and I think I rode it down the whole way down Indian Truck with a flat, and it was miserable. Mm-hmm. And then obviously it was so hot at that point where we were like, dude, we're over it. Like, yeah. let's go home, try again another day.
Okay, so how does mountain bike endurance cross-country racing pain compare to, say, the last two laps of a national at Southwick when it's 100 degrees?
It's so different. I mean, by far that was the gnarliest pain that I've ever been in, like as far as just mentally. And I feel like, especially at this point, like when I was 16, yeah, it wasn't hard to put me, even like 16 to 20, it wasn't very hard to put me in a mode of like, I hate this, or negativity, or like where you're mm-hmm. battling that kind of like quitting attitude, mm-hmm. Which I haven't felt like I really wanted to quit that bad in a really long time. Racing, it's like, yeah, you get tired and you maybe get the chills and you're a little bit dehydrated and stuff, but you can kind of push the end off of adrenaline. I mean, unless you really don't give a shit. Like, I don't really know how you can give up in that. Mm-hmm. But then again, like, then you go to this, something I've never trained for or experienced. And that's another thing I was pretty proud of myself too, because I did my own training. Yeah, I asked questions about some nutrition and stuff like that, but I did my own nutrition leading up and then throughout the race and it worked. Mm-hmm. So that's something I was more proud of, honestly, than anything. Because mm-hmm. I mean, I've never trained or done anything for more than 2.5 hours. Like, that's just not, yeah. I don't do that.
Are you in better shape now than when you were racing, because now you're a trainer and you train with your guys?
I think smarter. I think there was a point in like 13, 14 that I was definitely fitter than I am right now. Mm-hmm. I was riding. I mean, I look back on that. Like, you know, you can look on Strava and look back on certain, you know, years or whatever. I mean, I don't know. Honestly, at one point, I don't know what I was doing. Like, I would land on a Sunday from here, and Fed and I would go do 60 miles yeah. from a race. Like, we'd land from Unadilla and go do 60 miles on our bikes. And, like, so did it teach me a ton? Yes. And did it make me who I am? Yes. And then it made me very mentally tough. But now being on this side, it's like I kind of realized you have to move things around to – basically, if you're really good on your bicycle, it's going to hurt you on your dirt bike, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. So I think, do I still love it more than ever? Yeah, I do. Like, it's something that I don't really ride that much anymore. So this is my out.
Mm-hmm. Who's the strongest in your camp, fitness-wise, overall fitness?
Overall fitness, I mean, it's kind of probably got to be JB, just from the base years of, I mean, he's done it his whole life, and he's mm-hmm. also been a hell of a cyclist a lot of points in his life. He's worked with OSHO, he's worked with good guys as far as that goes, so, and I don't think anybody's ever questioned his fitness. Mm-hmm. By the numbers, just being honest, I would say it's probably Pierce, by just purely genetics and numbers and if you're going off scientifically. But then Mosey, you know, there was days out here where he would leave us in the dust. You know, like the ride behind my house is one of those ones where we kind of did a character building ride in the off season, and Mosey did it like he'd done it 100 times. So it was like, it's very different. Josh was a little bit more green when he came on, and a little bit late, so we've been behind the eight ball, but I'm really looking forward to off season with him and kind of build up with him, because I think he's really coming into his own right now.
You know why Pierce is strong? It's the Asian genes.
I was going to say Utah, but if you want to go there, that's fine.
All right, guys, we're going to take another quick break. We'll be back for more. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Here with Wilbur. So, do you like the position you're in right now? Like, is this where you pictured yourself when you retired from racing?
No. To be quite honest, like, and it's easy to take for granted a lot of the times, but I didn't think I'd have like this sort of career in general 6-7 years after I was done racing. Mm-hmm. I wasn't sure that I even stay in it. You know, you don't know how that stuff's going to work. And then you see guys come and go, or guys struggle with retirement because they're not in it or not in the spotlight. So I didn't really know. I mean, did I want to be a team manager? Yeah, I did 100%. And that was the plan. Like, I knew that, like, as I started dwindling and I knew the end was near, I knew that that's what I was going to do. But did I see this also opening up a door and this happening? And not really, no. Mm-hmm. Was it a passion of mine? Of course. Like, I still trained every day when I was done racing. So it was like one of those things where there's the passions there, but did I think it would be a career? Not necessarily, no. Mm-hmm. But to answer your question, I absolutely love it, yes.
Yeah. I mean, you're still involved. You're still influential, and you still get to exercise and train and pass your knowledge on.
There's plenty of days where I have to wake up and kind of pinch myself, right? Because the fact that I still get to go to all the races. If I want to ride a bike, it's a factory bike. I get to be fit. My job's to be more fit and to be around these guys and just help them kind of take out those S turns in life that I made that you just don't need to make, right? That are preventable. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very flattering, the fact that I even get to do that. Yeah.
Yeah. What would you say for someone watching the show, right? They're like, oh man, you know, the weekend warrior guy that raced, you know, ride Saturday and race to Sunday, you know, maybe sneaks out for a night session at Paris or something. Like, what's like an easy thing you could do to be more fit for motocross?
To be honest, I feel like the best all around stuff, if you have 30 minutes a day, which that's most people have, is probably in the morning or in the evening, do some runs obviously get on a bicycle if you can. Like, there's so many options now with all these e-bikes and and I mean, it's the easiest on your joints, especially as you get older. I understand that not people want to run, but then, dude, like, the best all-around machine you can get is a ski rig. Like, from concept two, I do believe that. Like, if you have one item you have to have in your garage the rest of your life and you can only do 20 minutes a day, get a ski rig. It'll kick your ass. It hurts every time, no matter how fit you get. Go do it.
I have one.
I have one too, and I hardly use it, dude. I need to use it more, but the reality is it's pain and suffering, but it's a full body workout. Yeah. It's perfect.
Well, you got to teach me how to use it, right? So I bought it.
Dude, you've been great at skiing your whole life.
I've never skied, but I bought the thing, right? So it's the thing, you know, the ropes that come down, right?
They didn't catch that.
What?
What? How do you do it?
But I got it, right? And I see all you guys on Instagram showing your pace and all that. So I was like, oh. And this was still when I was racing cross country. So I was like, okay. And I did it so hard, I made myself vomit, right?
Oh, you know, it's pain.
And then I did it the next day. The first day I did it for 20 minutes straight. And then the next day I did it for like 5 minutes. I was like, pah. Dude, I have like pillows and blankets and stuff stacked on the base of it now, like in our bedroom.
So did you wake up the next day? Because the first time I did it, like, I've been rowing forever, right? Because that was like, we warmed up doing that. And it was, again, great full body workout. But it didn't do what the ski did to me. Like, my core was so wrecked. And then my quads were pretty tight. And then, dude, my triceps were like, it was like I've never worked out a day in my life. And I'm like, it's like head to toe, I'm frazzled.
Yeah. Okay, so if I'm going to go dust that thing off right now, what's a realistic program on that thing?
I think to start and not burn yourself, it's not going to be the pace you want. Or not the pace you're seeing online, right?
Yeah, but do I go off heart rate or do I go off time?
I think totally, but I think honestly time. I think sometimes heart rate can be, it's a great tool to utilize, but at the same time, everyone's is so different. For me to be like, hey, go do 150 heart rate. I don't know your genetics. I don't know your fitness test, and I don't know your score. It could be way off. That 150 for you to sustain could be almost unfathomable, which, like, and for me, it might be totally easy. Mm-hmm. So without knowing that, I would go off a pace, like a 210 pace on a ski. Like, that's more than enough, and it's hard. Or even 220 on the ski, dude. Like, it's not the same as a row machine. Row machine 2 to 210 is somewhat easy to keep in. Mm-hmm. That thing, I mean, 220, you're going to get a workout whether you like it or not. And plus, I don't know if they program the clock to go slower than actual time. But it's somehow 20 like minutes it. Seems like maybe 40.
Yeah. The first time I did it, I was going, and you know, you can't look at anything. I have my eyes closed when I'm doing it.
Yeah.
And I like open my eyes to see the time, and I'm like, oh.
Yeah.
And my wife was laughing because she goes, I could hear you like grunt with disappointment every couple minutes.
Well, yeah, because it feels like, oh, it's at least been 5, and you're like a minute 43.
Yeah.
And you're like, how, yeah. Dude? I'm already smoked. But no, and I think on top of that, I think it's eating a little bit better, but just getting out and getting some exercise. And honestly, for riding, I really feel like the biggest thing that's overlooked is, like, we all want this quick fix and like how to get fit, but nothing replaces riding either.
Yeah.
Like, the more you can ride, the better. And I know that's not feasible for everybody, but that's honestly the truth.
So with your guys, Pierce, Justin, Joshua, and Michael, are you just their physical trainer? Are you helping them on the track, technique, point out lines and stuff? Like,
For sure, I'm there to help with all that as well. Like, Pierce and I last week worked like specifically on a bit of technique, and the guys need it at times, and sometimes they don't. But obviously, at a professional level, they all know how to ride, but everyone needs reminded a lot of times too, and majority of the time, it's just the basics.
Mm-hmm. So, going to a race, what are your duties on a race day?
So racing is, well, a lot of the times, I mean, to be honest with you, I go with Pierce. I travel with Pierce quite a bit, and him being from here, living here the whole time. So we're kind of always on the same schedule, stay with him. For the most part, it's their food, their nutrition, their bottles, everything all throughout the day, and then lines that I see. And then also, like, I'm doing lap times most of the time, calling it to mechanics or something I see that you can relate to the rider as well. I go to the gate with them, but it seems like they sell me out on the gate. Even though there's 30 of us up there helping the riders with gates, it seems like I'm the one that gets yelled at every weekend, which I don't know if it's because I know it's damn near not my height that they can just spot me and see me.
Yeah.
So I don't know why I get yelled at every weekend, but I get yelled at every weekend for that.
All right. Well, hey, unfortunately, we're out of time. Dude, congrats on the accomplishment. I mean, that's, I know people watching this are probably like, oh, they're talking about mountain bikes. But dude,
well, to put it in perspective, like going off of like polar and then like, so the biggest thing was like my nutrition, right? Like I knew that would be the biggest important thing. So everyone will, I think, respect this a little bit more, is how much that I had to put in to keep going. Like I think I ended up, I might butcher this a little bit without having it written down in front of me, but I ended up having, I think, 12 or 13 bottles total. Seven of those bottles were 320 calories each. I had two Uncrustables. I had 10 gels, which are 100 calories each with and heavy carbs as well.
Mm-hmm.
Four more waffles, some other like Cliff Blocks. I'm going to forget some stuff here, but in theory, like, I mean, I ended up burning that day total. When I went to bed, it was 7,200 calories.
Oh, Jesus.
So that's a lot of fucking calories to keep up on. Yeah. And I ate damn near equally to that, if not more. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty wild.
Yeah. You going to do it again?
Yeah, 100%.
Are you?
Yeah. I don't know why, but yeah.
When they have an e-bike class, I'll do it with you.
Well, there was e-bike charging stations. I was so confused.
Really?
I didn't know if it was real or not. I still don't know. I mean, but you're kind of like out of it, obviously, when you're riding. But I saw e-bike charging, and I'm like, what? There's e-bikes here?
All right. Hey, we're out of time. Cool. Got to have you on again.
Thanks.
And guys, thanks for watching. Make sure to tune in next week.